8:36, the Bible reads, "If the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be
free."
If the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. I got one witness. I got one witness over here. Somebody over here that knows it. In fact, the two brothers that were up here, they actually sang about that. I said, wow, they stole my message. And then the guy started preaching. I know he's not going to go do that. He's stepping all over my words. Listen, when was the last time you really took the time to consider the degree to which Jesus set you free? When was the last time you really took time out? Now I'm talking about quality time. Forget about going through the motions, because we do a really good job of that. We know when to stand up in church, when to sit down. We know when to give, when not to give. We know when to shout, when not to shout. We know when to clap our hands and when not to. We're religiously perfect. But when was the last time you really took the time to consider what Jesus Christ did for you on the cross many, many, many years ago? See, we have to do this from time to time so that we can keep it fresh in our hearts and in our minds. We really need to understand what Jesus Christ did to ensure our freedom. How many really know tonight that you've been set free by Jesus Christ? Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Now listen. We know that we've been set free. I don't think there's a soul in here who fails to some degree to understand the wonderful work of Jesus Christ on the cross. There may be somebody here who doesn't know Jesus personally, but I think even that individual understands that Jesus Christ died on the cross for him and for her. The point is that everybody knows that Jesus died on the cross for our sins, even though not everybody is experiencing that on a personal way. Life is challenging, and we all understand that. I think when times get tough in our lives, somehow, some way, because of the nature of the problem, because of the nature of the circumstance, it's during that season in our lives when we get to the place, for whatever reason, where we begin to take the cross for granted. We begin to take for granted the work, the magnificent work that Jesus Christ did for us on the cross long ago, and what he actually provided for us by dying on the cross. And tonight I want to share a couple of those things. In spite of the challenges, in spite of the difficulties, we ask ourselves a question from time to time. Okay, I know that Jesus Christ died, but if he truly died to set me free, why is it that life is so challenging? Why is it that I have so many problems and so many issues? Why am I dealing with so many circumstances that are so beyond my control? Jesus truly died to set us free.
Thank you, Lord.
When Jesus Christ died on the cross,
yes,
he died,
yes,
to truly set you free.
Hallelujah.
And we're going to get into that just a little bit.
Yes,
I got one witness. I just got one witness over here. Just one witness. I want to share a verse with you. And this is where I'm going to get my points. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30. And the verse reads, "But of him," listen, "but of him are you in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption." It's saying that when we are in Christ, anybody give the help to Jesus Christ?
Woo!
Any Christians that are out? Let me just see your hands. You know Jesus, let me see your hands. The day you chose to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, God, through his grace, by what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross, by faith, We have personal access to these provisions in Christ Jesus. In Christ Jesus, the wisdom of God has been made manifest in our lives. In Christ Jesus, the righteousness of God has been made manifest in our lives. In Christ Jesus, sanctification has been made manifest in our lives. And also, number four, in Christ Jesus, the redemption of God in Christ Jesus has been made manifest in our lives. If there's one verse in the Bible that best captures the work of the cross, it's right here in this verse. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30. It's the gospel right there in its entirety. Those four biblical doctrines. Now I'm just going to briefly mention a couple things concerning each one. The wisdom of God is number one. When I think about the wisdom of God, I think about Christ himself. John 1:1 says, and the Word was with God, and the Word
was God.
The Word was God. One more time, one more time. In the beginning was, actually, does it begin by saying in the beginning?
Uh-huh.
In the beginning was the Word.
In the beginning was the Word.
And the Word was with God.
And the Word was God.
Was with God.
Was God.
Amen. Exactly. Exactly. Listen to me. The wisdom of God is Christ himself. The Word of God manifested and became flesh. When you and I accepted Jesus Christ into our lives, God made his wisdom available to you and I in the form of Christ Jesus. And when I think about the wisdom of God, I think about John 8:32, where it says that you shall know the truth, and the truth shall
set you free.
And you should know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. What a wonderful way to begin this one particular verse. God has set us free in more ways than you and I can ever imagine. And I think that when we leave here tonight, my job is just to give you an idea. Your job is to do a little more research on this matter so you can thoroughly understand what God did for you on the cross. Because that's who Jesus Christ was. There aren't three gods, there's just one God. And there's one God, our loving Father, our Creator. He chose to manifest himself in physical form for the purpose of going to the cross so that we might have life and have it more abundantly.
Yes.
Amen, somebody. I got one witness over here. That's why Jesus Christ died. The wisdom of God. Listen, the wisdom of God, it's wonderful. John 14:6, Jesus Christ once said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. What a wonderful provision that God has made available to you and I. His wisdom. The Bible says, one of my favorite passages, I mention this almost every time, in the book of Proverbs, where it talks about how the wisdom of God cries out in the streets. The wisdom of God cries out in the marketplaces, at the entrance and the exits of the city street, the city gates. The wisdom of God is always proclaiming, always declaring. God is always desiring for his people, as well as his creation in general, to understand what his purpose is for our lives. God doesn't want for us, doesn't want us to wander through life aimlessly, without meaning, without purpose, without understanding. He wants us to know exactly what he has in store for every single one of us. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And the only way that that is going to happen is for you and I to get connected with his wisdom. For you and I to understand what he has to say to us as individuals. The wisdom of God. Number two, the righteousness of God. Jesus fulfilled the law in its entirety. And by faith, Romans 5:1 says that by faith we have access to God. And we have peace with God. The one word that I love the most concerning that passage is justification. It's the one word that best fits with this one doctrine right there, the doctrine of righteousness, the righteousness of God. Jesus, or rather in Christ, we have been declared righteous. Somebody needs to hear that. Because somebody here is loaded down with misery. Somebody here is loaded down with depression. Somebody here is loaded down with the tax collector, the bill collectors, and the drama, and everything else that you got going on in your life. Somebody here needs to understand that you've been declared righteous. That if you find yourself here tonight in Christ, if you are in Christ, you need to understand that you've been declared righteous by God. Hallelujah. Psalms 32 says that sin is no longer imputed. No longer imputed. Because we are clothed with the righteousness of God.
Amen.
Number three, sanctification. Sanctification actually means to set apart from sin unto God. To devote something. And we have the sanctification of God that has been manifested. I don't know about you, but it's taken place in my life. I believe that God has set me apart from sin unto himself. How many agree with me? In Colossians chapter 1, verse 13, the Bible says that we've been translated. You got to get this. We've been translated from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. The standard is no longer the same. The wrath of God is no longer upon us, addressed to us. When we were children of disobedience, the wrath of God was automatically just hounding us automatically because of sin, because of disobedience, because of unrighteousness. But to be sanctified by God in Christ Jesus is to be set apart. The standard is new, it's different. Sin is no longer reckoned in a sense. And God looks upon us through the lens of Jesus Christ.
Amen, bro.
He sees Christ in us. In spite of your trouble, in spite of your circumstances, in spite of your issues, you need to know that you've been sanctified by God if you are in Christ. Somebody here needs to understand that. Because it's going to help you stay in recovery. It's going to help you stay sober. You need to know that God loves you. You need to know that. Somebody here needs to know that God loves you. In Christ, God has taken you away. He has literally snatched you from the kingdom of darkness and planted you in the kingdom of his dear son, Jesus Christ. He set you apart, and you are special. And lastly, redemption. To purchase, to pay the price, to pay the debt. The Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. And Romans 6:23 declares that the wages or the penalty or the reward of sin is death. It's talking about eternal damnation. It's talking about eternal damnation. So we need it for one day for God to manifest himself, to go to the cross. Jesus had to die. Even if there was just one person on the planet to die for, he would have done it nonetheless. Because it was necessary in order for you and I to be allowed or to have access to heaven. He had to die because he had to pay the price. The price was death. Jesus had to shed his blood, and he literally had to go to hell in our place. Study the Bible, Ephesians chapter 2. It tells us that he literally went to hell in our place. He purchased our salvation with his blood. Number one, the wisdom of God. It's the truth of God that will set you free. Number two, righteousness. You don't have to consider yourself to be the ugly person that you've always considered yourself to be. You are in right standing with God if you are in Christ. You don't have to be perfect to be saved. You just have to be in Christ. Don't worry about what your neighbor is saying. Don't worry about what your church is saying, what the person next to you is saying. Don't worry about the looks that people give you. If you are in Christ, hallelujah. If you are in Christ, the righteous. righteousness of God is a part of your life. Number three, you've been sanctified by God. You've been set apart by God. You are special. You are His own. You belong to Him. Somebody needs to understand that. And number four, you've been purchased with the blood of Jesus Christ.
Thank you. Amen.
Bow your heads with me. Come on. Indulge me.